One of the pleasures of 80 years and 10 is having leisure to look backward. My first recollections are of Ringgold, Georgia. The summers of my childhood were all spent at the Whitman house. All I saw is as vivid as the scenes of today, but there are memories other than what the eye took in. Mary Lane McMillan, 1960.
A house is simply a structure made of wood and brick until someone fills it with memory, laughter, tears, and love and makes it a home. The Whitman Anderson House, located here in Ringgold, Georgia, has certainly seen its share of these. One of the few remaining antebellum homes, it has shared the lives of 5 generations of families. It all began with William Lane Whitman, born May 12, 1825. William, along with brothers Thomas and George, left their homes in Athens, Georgia in 1847 for a prospecting tour of North Georgia. Their destination was the new town of Dalton, but William decided Ringgold was the place he wanted to stay.
So it was really a railroad boom town, filled with entrepreneurs and the latest in technology, and this is the reason probably that Whitman came. Whitman and his two brothers, Thomas and George, were from Athens. And in 1847, as young men, they left Athens, got on the train, and took the train to Atlanta, and then got on the new W&A Railroad and came north as far as Resaca, because in 1847, Resaca was the end of the line. They caught a stagecoach then on into to Ringgold. William Whitman went into a partnership with James Lee, put up a store and brought a stock of goods, probably from Augusta, if I had to guess about it, and went into business. Then both of them married, and Lee's wife lived for about a year, and she died. And then Lee sold his interest in the store out to a man by the name of Thomas Wooten. Wooten kept it for about a year and then sold his half to Whitman. And then Whitman again went in partnership with a man by the name of Joseph Witchett, who was a very prominent businessman here in Catoosa County. And Whitman and Witchett were the ones that built the 3 stores there on the corner of Tennessee and Nashville Street. They were very prominent in town. Whitman was known as a very good merchant, a very Christian man, very moderate man, and a leader of the community.
Whitman married Cordelia A. Young in 1851, and they had a daughter, Alice Lula. Unfortunately, Cordelia died in 1857. Whitman married again a year later to Cordelia's sister, Margaret, and they had 8 children, starting with Martha in 1859, all the way to Earl, born in 1879.
Much of what we know about Margaret and William and their family has been discovered in the writings of their granddaughter, Mary Lane McMillan. She compiled her memories and important documents and created the Moss Rose album. In it, we learn that Margaret had many admirers before her marriage to William.
In this I am offering give, an offering true to thee, that I trust will ever live through a great eternity.
No matter whence I go or where I stay, for thee, Miss Mag, there'll ever be that friendship which can only be completed in eternity.
A cheek unblemished by darkened tears, a smile for every future morrow. February 24th, 1857.
One letter included was from William himself, written to Margaret 1 month before the passing of Cordelia.
Dear Margaret, till now, no doubt, your life has been all a bright dream, in which you have shadowed forth a bright future for yourself. So it is with all who have trod the morning of life, but you have yet to tread that part of life's pathways thickest beset with the temptations peculiar to women. May you have strength to resist them, and all your bright dreams be realized, and your heart, as ever, beat responsive to the virtues which we find embedded in the good, the true, and the noble of your sex. William, February 15th, 1857.
My grandmother Margaret had an inner urge to be always busy in behalf of those she loved. She could not be idle. Once when she was visiting me, she begged for something to do. "Haven't you something I could rip up for you?" I gave her a petticoat with yards of lace insertion. It gave her pleasure for the entire visit. After she left, I put the skirt back as it was. And to my dear grandfather, she was the best, the truest, and the noblest of her sex.
On September 1st, 1869, the Masonic Lodge of Ringgold formed a stock company to erect a school for the citizens of Catoosa County. Mr. Whitman served on the school committee along with D.S. Anderson and Reverend A.I. Leet. He was also involved in the history of the Old Stone Church and was a pioneer landowner and merchant in Ringgold.
William Whitman was the worshipful master of Quitman Lodge, number 106, the Masonic Lodge in Ringgold. After the war was over, the Masons of Ringgold saw a desperate need to build a school for the children of Catoosa County. Remember that Ringgold and much of Catoosa County was desolate. It had been destroyed by the war. People had lost everything. Men were returning from the war. They had been wounded. Their families may have disappeared to refugee camps. The area was in desperate need, and the Masons saw that one of the ways to combat this was to build a school and to educate the children of Catoosa County and of the Ringgold area. William Whitman helped to spearhead this effort and encouraged the Masons of Ringgold, of Quitman Lodge, to buy stocks. And the money earned off of those stocks helped to build the two-story brick building that once stood there, known as the Masonic Literary Institute.
Among all his other tremendous accomplishments, Mr. Whitman built this beautiful home in 1857. Originally of Georgian architecture, it was modified in 1915. Additions were made with the columns and the upstairs porch. The walls are approximately 15 inches thick and the ceilings about 12 feet high. It has the original heart pine floors and the bricks are handmade. The window panes are made of hand-blown glass and the doorknobs are porcelain. This home is listed on the National Register of Historic Places.
Under the lovely stairs in the Whitman House was a closet, and I shall always remember the sweet smell of great sacks of dark brown sugar, the odor of dried apples in other sacks, and the somewhat musty odor from sacks filled with gingham and calico scraps left from the many garments and used for piecing quilts.
The best known and most important historic facts about this house occurred during the American Civil War. During the battles of Chattanooga and Ringgold, Union General Ulysses S. Grant used this house as his headquarters. Many reporters traveled with the two armies during the Civil War and reported their findings in newspapers, journals, and books. One such reporter was William W. Smith. He wrote of his travels with Grant in November of 1863.
At Rossville, we leave the valley and take the road up to Missionary Ridge. From the top of the ridge, we could occasionally catch the thunder of distant artillery. When we crossed the third branch of the Chickamauga, the roar of the cannon and the crash of the musketry was startling. On reaching the top of the high bank on the east side, we found lying below us a pretty town. We found it was Ringgold. We galloped ahead to the shelter of the Stone Railroad Depot where General Hooker was. There were a great many officers' horses in front of and protected by the depot. General Grant, determined to stay here till tomorrow, sent out Dunn and Parker to hunt up a house for quarters. In about half an hour, they return and report that they have found a good place. It is quite a handsome, new two-story house standing about 30 feet back from the street with a pretty yard about it. The family consists of an old man, two intelligent, good-looking women, a pretty little miss, about 14, and two younger children. They are shy and somewhat dumbfounded at this sudden inroad of North men. The old man kindles wood fires in the three rooms allotted us, and the women prepare to get supper for 15. They say they have plenty of cornbread and port, but no coffee. The general is the first of our party to come to our new quarters. The lady of the house meets him, and looking at him as an intruder, tells him she is preparing for General Grant. When the general replies, "That is my name," she looked astonished and instantly became very gracious, but you could still see a suppressed dislike. The general noticed and petted the children, which made the mother look on him as not such a bad man after all.
During his stay at the Whitman House, General Grant offered the two Whitman daughters a doll for each of them. The older daughter supposedly threw hers down and refused it, but the younger daughter decided to keep hers.
In the early part of 1900, my mother, Martha Cordelia, and her brother's wife, Alice Whitman, were sightseeing in New York. They had a long day of it, and when they descended the steps of Grant's tomb, my mother sat down to rest on one of the steps. My aunt said, "Oh, sister, I believe that is forbidden." My mother tilted her chin up and replied, "I sat on Grant's knee once as a little girl. I believe he would not object to my resting here a moment on the steps of his tomb." And she sat.
There is a legend handed down that on the day General Grant and his men left the Whitman house, he offered Mrs. Whitman payment for her hospitality. But she refused, saying she wouldn't accept Yankee greenbacks. She wanted to be paid in Confederate money. General Grant remarked, "There's one Southerner that's not whipped yet," and he and his Union soldiers left cheering Mrs. Whitman out of respect for her loyalty to the Confederacy. Another documented stay at the Whitman house came from a Major James Austin Connolly from Illinois. He was stationed in Ringgold in the winter of 1863 and 1864 with General Baird's division. This was the time between the Battle of Ringgold and Sherman's advance towards Atlanta in May. He was a proficient letter writer to his fiancée, May Dunn. She saved his letters, and they were published in Transactions of the Illinois State Historical Society for 1928, and later compiled in a book titled 3 Years in the Army of the Cumberland. His letters describe his stay at the Whitman House and the town of Ringgold.
March 10th, Wilder's Brigade of Mounted Infantry was the first federal force that entered Ringgold. That was last September, and this was then a handsome town of about 1,000 inhabitants. But now the scars of war mar its beauty, and save for a few scattering houses, nothing but shapeless piles of brick and lone chimneys is left to mark the site of the town of Ringgold. March 16th, I am boarding with a retired merchant and furnishing the leading rations. His son didn't like me at first, said I was a Yankee, he wouldn't speak to me. Didn't like Yankees because they burned Pa's store and killed our cow. But after many promises to let him ride my horse, I have so far succeeded in overcoming his prejudice against Yankees as to induce him to sit on my lap. The retired merchant is a Mr. Whitman. When Wilder's brigade first came through here last fall before the Battle of Chickamauga, it carried away on horseback his entire stock of goods, whereupon he put the key of his store in his pocket and retired. I am sorry for him, for he is a very moderate man and a Christian. I know, for he says grace over a very scanty meal. His wife is a good woman, barring her success sentiments. Really, and in sober earnest, I am living more comfortably now than I have since I've been in the service, and would be content to do the rest of my soldiering in Ringgold. But I don't expect to do it all here by any means. I have only 17 more months to serve anyhow, and that is a consolation.
Our ancestor, William Lane Whitman, was a devout Christian. He believed determined opponents won little of lasting value by waging war. He believed there were other ways of settling difficulties. For citizens of one country to fight against citizens of the same country seemed to him unthinkable. At the beginning of the war, the hiring of a substitute was not only permitted, but no censure was attached to it. Our grandfather paid a large sum of money to a substitute, a man with no family obligations, who fought all through the war and returned without wounds. Grandfather was neutral in his actions, other than hiring a substitute, and during the war he gave aid to neither side, but being a Southerner, his sympathy was with the South.
William and Margaret's oldest daughter, Martha Cordelia, married the Reverend James G. Lane, who was pastor at the Old Stone Church from 1872 to 1877. They had 3 daughters, Nola, Anne, and Mary. The 2 older girls were both born in the Whitman house. Mary, however, was born in Tuscumbia, Alabama in 1883, and she went on to achieve great success as an artist. Mary Lane McMillan was an American magazine and book illustrator and fine artist during the early to mid-20th century. She studied at the National Academy of Design in New York from 1902 to 1904. She also studied illustration and pictorial composition at the Chicago Art Institute. After her studies, she taught art at the Presbyterian College for Women in Milford, Texas, and was later head of the art department at Polytechnic College, now named Texas Wesleyan University. In 1910, she traveled to Florence, Italy to study under William Merritt Chase. In 1912, she left Texas for New York to begin her career as a book and magazine illustrator. During the 1930s, she ran the Macmillan School of Fine Arts in New Rochelle, New York, with her husband, George Macmillan, a piano teacher. In 1960, Mary decided to document the history of her family by compiling her memories and important documents into an album, which she titled the Moss Rose Album, named for the moss rose her family dug up in front of the Whitman house to take with them to Alabama so they would always have a piece of Ringgold with them. A critic in the 1920s described Mary's art as being transfused with atmosphere, splendid in composition and beautiful in color. Her artistic spirit and contribution to American art and illustration continue to be admired today. After the Civil War, the Whitmans, like so many families in the South, did their best to pick up the pieces and continue on. Mr. Whitman died in November of 1886. After 11 years, the family decided to rent their beloved home to J.A. Smith, who then bought the home in 1902, which brings us to our second generation of ownership of this beloved home place. At the age of 17, J.A. Smith enlisted in the 36th Infantry of the Confederate. Wounded three times, he received an honorable discharge. After recovering from his wounds, he re-enlisted in the 6th Cavalry, where he was promoted to captain. Unable to farm because of his wounds, he went into business in Boynton, Georgia. Later, he moved to Ringgold, where he was a successful merchant for many years. He sold caskets, coffins, and dry goods, and was a master mason. He married Carolyn Elizabeth Park in 1865, and they had four children, Horace, James, Mary, and Martha Ethel. The house moved into its third generation of ownership, with Mr. and Mrs. Smith's youngest daughter, Martha Ethel, and her husband, Ulrich Anderson. The couple was married here in this home in 1904, and later celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary here. The two had two children, Ulrich Jr. and Doris Carolyn Anderson. Ulrich worked on the Nashville, Chattanooga, and St. Louis Railroad, and was a member of the railroad trainmen for over 60 years, and he was a member of the Quitman Masonic Lodge 106, free and accepted Mason. Martha was active in the Baptist Church, and she was the oldest living member of the WMU and a member of the DAR. She died in February of 1962, and Ulrich followed 5 years later in 1967. The house then passed on to Ulrich and Martha's daughter, Doris, bringing us to the fourth generation of ownership.
She epitomized a true Southern gentlewoman, and she was the last of a dying breed. She still used a lace handkerchief. She was very polite. She was taught. She was from the old school where you still wore hats and white gloves and things like this. And she was very ladylike, and she had a heart of gold, but she was very... One thing that drew me to her, she's very down to earth and honest, and we became really good friends. She always told me that that house is the way she put it to me, this is my baby, and if it falls down, it can just fall down with around me. But I know she wanted it left to her family. And her two sons, Al and Andy, have ownership of the house, and Al has two daughters, and I understand one of them plans to live in the house one day. But I know she would want it open to the public. I know she would want people to share that experience because it's such a treasure.
We now come to our fifth and current generation of ownership, Albert Hudson Jr. and Charles Anderson Hudson. They are the sons of Doris and Al Sr. They both live in Atlanta, but come back from time to time to visit the beloved home place. Not much is known about the future of this house. Many local residents who grew up here in Ringgold feel that it is a treasure to be cherished and preserved. After all, it housed famous generals and survived Sherman's flames. It has witnessed the births, weddings, and deaths of five generations of families. This brick structure is more than a house. It is a tangible reminder of a time long forgotten and the people who inhabited it.
About 20 years ago, my mother, Cordelia Whitman Lane, placed in my hands the data which inspired me to design our family tree in the Moss Rose album. My mother's admonition as she gave the family data into my keeping was, "Take care of these notes of marriages, births, deaths, letters, and newspaper clippings, as they are things I treasure and should be treasured." What wonders we have beheld, and what blessings we have enjoyed that our ancestors never dreamed of.